Open up that Crystal Pepsi and get comfortable.
This is Dope Nostalgia.
So good to have you here today, everybody. My name's Naomi, your host of Dope Nostalgia. And my special guest today is a drummer in one of the most influential bands in the punk rock grunge era of the time, Meat Puppets. Formed back in 1980 in Phoenix, Arizona. I'll tell you more about them. Derek Bostrom is their drummer, and he's here with me today to talk about all the amazing things that they've done throughout their career. Here's a little bit of information on the Meat Puppets.
Wikipedia moment.
Please bear in mind that Wikipedia is not to be taken as actual 100% fact. Any donkey could edit it at any time. If I'm reading you the artist's bio, that stuff is the real truth.
Meat Puppets are an American rock band formed in January 1980 in Phoenix, Arizona. The group's original lineup was Kurt Kirkwood on guitar and vocals, his brother Chris Kirkwood, bass guitar and vocals, and Derek Bostrom on the drums. The Kirkwood brothers met Bostrom while attending Brophy Prep High School in Phoenix. The three then moved to Tempe, Arizona, where the Kirkwood brothers purchased two adjacent homes, one of which had a shed in the back where they regularly practiced. Meat Puppets started as a punk rock band, but like most of their label mates on SST Records, they established their own unique style, blending punk with country and psychedelic rock, and featuring Kurt's warbling vocals. Meat Puppets later gained significant exposure when the Kirkwood brothers served as guest musicians on Nirvana's MTV Unplugged performance in 1993. The band's 1994 album, Too High to Die, subsequently became their most successful release, featuring this song right here called Backwater. The band broke up twice in 96 and 2002, but reunited again in 2006. And to get a real detailed history of the story, this is an amazing interview. He has so much to share. Guys, welcome to Dope Nostalgia Podcast, Derek Bostrom. So my name's Naomi. Welcome, Derek, to Dope Nostalgia.
Really. Hi, Naomi. Hi, fans.
You became a group way back in the 80s, early?
1980, Kurt and I, actually in late 79, Kurt and I realized that we could probably play together. I was getting ready to quit my job, and Kurt had been fired from his, he had been frustrated in his attempt to join proper bands because he was too crazy. And I was like, dude, crazy is good, because I was into punk rock and he was still trying to like do, I don't know, wedding bands, bar bands. Mm-hmm. And he had been summarily rejected and had given up the guitar and was playing the drums. And I was like, in the band that I conceive of, you will be able to do whatever you want. And he was like, wow. So we started a very cool kind of punk rock bands by learning how to play all of my punk rock records, or some of them, the subset that we could play. Mm-hmm. And then slowly but surely moved on from writing simple rudimentary punk rock songs to Kurt getting into, slowly but surely, finding his own vision. Mm-hmm. We did a series of records on the label SST, which has achieved legendary status. The leader of that label, Greg Ginn, is a big proponent of helping out the homeless cat population in California, believe it or not. Oh, and then we jumped ship after we realized that we were exhausted from traveling on a shoestring, touring constantly, putting out records into the ether, to the vacuum, as it were. So we made the jump to a major label, much to our later chagrin, and then began to play the game. And that is, those are the early 90s are what Kurt and I have come to call the lost years, when we had to hire a manager, take on debt, let the label tell us what to do, and lost kind of touch with what we had started doing it for, and then through a series of overexposures to both other people's audiences and those bands as hard narcotics, one of our members experienced a protracted period of drug addiction, which he recovered from. During that same period, I split, got married, got a real job, and then through a series of happy circumstances, I rejoined the band, and we've been enjoying it ever since, until, of course, COVID, which has made it very, very difficult to remount a tour strategy. While we haven't put out a proper studio record since 2019, we have released at least one live record, and I'm in the process of getting out another live record, basically using our, the first live record we did was a series of recordings that we did in 2019. This one is actually, this new one is actually something that was done at the request of our label, which is to comb through some of our live archives and collect some of our coolest country songs, which we used to do from the 90s. And so I compiled something which will be called Camp Songs, which will just be covers of from some of our from our early 90s, which is not only a nice piece of history, but also a recognition that we have become, in the eyes of your probably definitely your Gen Zs, but possibly your millennials as well, nothing more or less than a bunch of red state rockers, a bunch of white guys who play a bunch of white rock and roll music that nobody in their right minds cares about under the age of 40. So, as you can imagine, we like 90s nostalgia as much as anybody, because that was during both our highest and our lowest period. Do you have a question?
You have covered so much ground right there.
That's my overview for you. Dig in.
I know the one thing I found about being a 90s nostalgic podcast is talking to people who are in rock music. They have some of the stories that will break your heart, because it was a tumultuous time for rockers, whether it be someone who's in a hair metal band or in a grunge band or whatever it was. It was just, there was so much of a time for change.
Well, yeah. We slugged it out in the trenches for years, and we always felt that we had something to offer, that we were like significant, but we were just too rough around the edges and not commercial enough. And I suppose it'll take 20 years after we're all dead for people to come back around and appreciate it as much as we might, if at all. But, you know, first we saw, you know, the first wave in like 85, the Husker Du's and the Replacements of the world started getting major label deals. And of course, at the time, major label deal was the bomb. The Replacements never really found their niche. Obviously, REM did really well. Then the Chili Peppers started coming in and kicking it out of the park. Jane's Addiction made a huge splash. We still couldn't get, a dance. We had actually gotten as far as the office of a fella named Gary Gersh, who was an important executive in, God, I cannot remember the label anymore, unfortunately. But he basically propped his shoeless feet up on the desk and told us that he couldn't market us because we were not marketable enough. But he really, Christ, I should have done my memory. One of these bands that were like two boys that looked both looked the same. And he was like, these guys are easy to market. You guys are impossible to market. So we're going to have to pass. So we kept slogging it out. The reason we ended up getting signed is because so many bands during the 80s in our club had a built-in audience. We had spent 10 years or so working hard, you know, touring constantly, putting out records on independent labels, and finally the big labels are like, we're gonna sign these guys because they've already done all the A&R work for us. And they have a built-in audience. We're not doing anything but scoop off the cream and then get rid of them when we're done with them. And it became almost impossible to work in the independent realm because so many of your top-level artists were getting signed to majors, thus depriving our independent network of both for distribution of records and all the labels and also clubs. Their major earners were being pulled out of them. So you take a label like SST, they would maybe release 20 records over the course of a cycle. Mm-hmm. You know, a few of them were like their top A-list artists, but they're also trying to break new ones. So inevitably, you're going to go to your distributor and you're going to go, look, here's my slate for this time. We'll give you a great break on the new Meat Puppets, but really we need you to look at some of our new artists. Well, without those like Meat Puppets or whatever, the distribution companies couldn't sell them. Eventually they started going out of business. And next thing you know, the labels are being, they're losing, you know, all the money that they're being owed by the distributors who are going bankrupt are not getting them. So the network starts to fall apart. And we're getting to the point where the bands that are opening for the Meat Puppets, whom we've never heard of, even back then, we were old farts. We're like getting like having like major label people coming back and schmoozing them, and their records would be in the record stores with all the posters and everything and the displays in the windows. You couldn't find our records. So we were like, we're killing ourselves here. So we signed to the major and we found, you know, the best deal we could. But inevitably, even though we did manage to get a gold record and lots of smoke blown up our ass by, you know, the distribution wings of our major labels. At the end of the day, after working our asses off to get a gold record for Too High to Die, we ended up hugely in the red to the labels, hugely in hock to them. And at the end of that, they were like, yeah, now we own you. And we literally had to pay them to get, we had to buy our contract from them for no small amount of money. And, but in the meantime, the band had already broken up and, you know, we were like just kind of in the wind with no real chance. The three of us weren't really dealing with each other. Kurt ended up having to try to pull the strings back together on his own. And it wasn't until years later that the three of us got back together. And, now we're having a wonderful time as an independent group. I just delivered like last week 10 records to our current label, which is Megaforce, who are out of New York, who have been very cool with us. Don't harass us at all about what we want to do. Don't even talk about the no doubt substantial pile of money they're losing on us. And and you know we're giving them our back catalog, or we're getting ready to release our back catalog through them. And while we have released our back catalog a couple of times, we got it back from SST in the early or in the late 90s, at which point I put together a comprehensive reissue program with lots of bonus tracks, the kind of stuff you would expect nowadays. And, you know, now what we're basically doing is releasing the CDs as with the bonus tracks intact, but we're releasing the vinyl versions in their original format.
Oh, wow.
And we're also re-releasing our first 45, our 7-inch EP, which we released in 81, as a 7-inch. Mm. And we're also going to, it'll also be available as a bonus track on the first album, which it was for years. And we're also reissuing our live album that I put together in 1998 called Live in Montana, the first record we did from our, you know, many, many crates of board tapes, which we recorded over the years, and expanding it into a 2-record set with some bonus tracks. It was never released on vinyl before because we had dealt with Ryko, who, speaking of 90s nostalgia, was one of your first. See, actually, that's 80s nostalgia. Your first CD only record labels. You remember when Ryko came out? They had David Bowie. They had Frank Zappa, I think. And they were like, CD. Remember, there's the only great new thing about CD. So a lot of these records seem to come out on vinyl through them. So we now own that stuff. So we're doing a vinyl only live in Montana. And the Camp Songs record is also probably going to be vinyl and streaming only. Don't get me started about streaming.
It's not a fun topic. Streaming is definitely not.
Well, if you're talking to
topic.
People who worked in the 90s, you're probably going to grumble. I just finished reading a really wonderful book by Cory Doctorow and his co-author, Rebecca Gitlin, I think, called Choke Point Capitalism, about all the wonderful ways in which the man is using technology to further put the screws to the creative class, as it were. And it's a real, real interesting book. It's not anything that that I didn't know before, but it's nice to like go, here, read this. If you want to know why Meat Puppets aren't coming to your town this month, here, read this. So, and that, you know, brings us to a whole nother thing is like, now that social media is free, the idea of using anything else besides Facebook to promote your art is unheard of. And back in the old days, I literally had I had one of them Rolodexes. Remember those?
Yes.
Anytime somebody sent us a letter, I would put their name on a little card and put it in my Rolodex. I might even still have it. Mm-hmm. And occasionally, you know, try to send everybody a little postcard with tour dates on it. I even tried to do a little a newsletter for a while, which was too much for me to handle. It was like when I got my first computer in 1994, I tried to put together a little desktop publishing newsletter and with comics and ads for t-shirts and stuff. And what I found was, if you're gonna offer to send people t-shirts for money, you better be prepared for people to tell you, oh, I never got my t-shirt. And we didn't do that for very long. We still sell merch now. We have dedicated people who love us as much as the Grateful Dead's employees loved them, who will help us keep our stuff afloat. And we still sell merch online and stuff like that. But unfortunately, though we tried to get back on the road last year, we all got COVID. It was like, okay, we're going to try to do this without COVID. Oh, we all got COVID. One of us got very, very sick. We realized, crap, we're old. So we are now much more slowly agreeing to do stuff. We've got one show for this year that we've agreed to do. That's a festival out in, where is it? It's in Nevada somewhere. I don't remember where it is right off the bat. I'm not prepared to promote.
We can look it up for later.
We don't have anything else going. And what I found is a lot of people cancel, obviously during the last 3 years, and really screwed a lot of these smaller promoters. And we were trying to, we're not heavily hooked into the Live Nation reality. We still kind of work with the same booking agent that we started working with in 1984. We started 83. We started working with a fellow named Frank Riley. And he's been in our court ever since, him and his company, High Road Touring. And if it weren't for them, I don't know what we would do, but they've been very kind to us. They see the value in a band of ne'er-do-wells like us, much in the same way that a young winner would stick with Hunter Thompson long after he was able to, meet deadlines. We still are able to go out and get good shows, but we really aren't working a lot right now, unfortunately. Maybe that will change.
Well, I'm just glad to know that you guys all got through the COVID experience. Okay. I know it's been rough on
the COVID
every artist. The COVID experience.
I mean, I didn't mind getting it. I've been much, much sicker on the road. I always find that if you go to Europe, if you're not used to Europe, that the European bugs will get you, and they feel even like a common cold. If you're not used to the European bugs, it'll make you feel really crummy.
First time being exposed to it makes sense, right?
Yeah, but COVID was just like, my only concern about COVID is when am I supposed to go back to work? So apparently they're like, as long as you're not symptomatic, you can come back to work. Don't test yourself, because if you test positive, then we'll have to like not let you work again. But you're not, you know, it was like, oh yeah, I get it. You want us to work. But anyway, I'm retired now. So just about the time I retired is about the time we started pulling back a lot of our live commitments. Hopefully we'll start that again, because you have no idea how much I would love to go out on the road. You can tell I'm just a bundle of passion about my music. Yep. I just love to.
I love it. About it. What made you start playing drums in the first place?
Well, the first time I started playing the drums was when I used to take coffee cans and put them on the backs of chairs and play along to my Banana Splits record back in 1969 when I was 9 years old. So my mom bought me a very small set of children's drums, which my younger brother promptly destroyed. Ooh. I didn't play the drums again until I had a buddy who was really into Jimi Hendrix, and he really loved to play guitar. And one year I was like, I should get some drums. And my mom got me another pair of Sears drums, which I played until it accumulated more stuff. Meanwhile, that buddy moved away, and I started playing with the Kirkwoods, and I got really into punk rock when I first heard it. As an old hippie from a young hippie from the 70s, I was like, oh, this, I get this. I get what this is about. Mm. And I really took to punk rock as soon as I heard about it when I was like 17, and just wanted to play. And by the time we're old enough to drink, bars started to grudgingly let certain bands play, and we were able to like do well. And there were promoters that were doing punk rock, and we were crazy enough to draw a crowd. And we had friends in California, and who were in bands, and they got us shows in California, which led us to run into people who wanted to put out records with us. Once we started working with SST, they had a network of clubs and stuff, because Black Flag had played so much. So we were able to leap onto their touring circuit, and we toured with them. We did one tour with them for like 6 weeks. Mm. Slowly but surely, through nothing but hard work. It seemed hard to us, but then we were like potheads, so it probably wasn't that hard. You probably worked harder on your podcast than we ever worked on our music, but it was hard work. And I don't know. I just, something about, I never was super into music when I was a kid, but once I heard punk rock, I like, it all sort of clicked in my head. I was into the Sex Pistols before I'd even heard the Rolling Stones. And yet,
wow.
I didn't get into the Rolling Stones until I happened to go to a yard sale where I found like a dozen Rolling Stone records for a dime a piece, and I bought them all, and slowly but surely figured out what was what. And even now I'm not, not a huge fan of the Rolling Stones, but either way, I don't know. I just got really into it. I really found my niche, and it was great, because Chris and Kurt are the same kind of losers that I am. They're just like, we're not good for anything but each other. We're not suitable for anything but for what we do. I'm not worthy of talking to you on this podcast, as you could probably tell. Your audience will certainly be able to tell.
Don't sell yourself short. Come on.
it's a humble brag, I believe, is what we call it.
Yeah.
but no, it's just, I I didn't play. I stopped playing drums in about 1995, when 96, when the band collapsed the first time after drug abuse and you know, the end of the major label American Dream. And I got a proper job, got married, did all the things, and built up my nest egg, and then just really started hating it. Not the marriage part. I love the marriage part, but the job part. And managed to slowly but surely, you know, get that that off my back. And I just loved to play the drums, for better or for worse.
There was a solo EP around that time too, wasn't there?
Yeah, I did a solo record of like when I was really into bubblegum pop music. I did this record with I had an Archie's track on it, and did a version of Pac-Man Fever. It was cute. I still have a big box of unsold copies in my closet, which I take out on the road on and see if I can sell a few. Don't. Chris and I still get together and play at least once a week, just bass and drums usually. Elmo, our second guitarist, Kurt's son, is in town. He plays with us sometimes. Kurt lives in Austin. We have a keyboard player who lives in Pennsylvania, and he'll come out, he'll drive out a couple times a year and we'll jam. But really, I just like to go. It just doesn't amount to much, but it feels good.
And that's what matters. It's your outlet.
To me, yeah, definitely. Doesn't make us a lot of money, but it's sure a lot of fun. And I can't relate. I was listening. I was like, my wife listens to NPR, and she was out this morning when I got up. And I'll get out and go and say hello to the good morning to the cats, and the NPR will be on. And I was heard some damn kid talking about her new record with all of that NPR vocal fry and up talking and all the crap that the Gen Zs do. And she's like, going, "Oh, I think that my new record's as good as anything that's out on the market right now." I'm like, sheesh, whatever. I don't relate to the music business at all. I didn't relate to the music business then. There was a time, as I mentioned, when you know, the Replacements and the Husker Du were starting to get a lot of contracts. And I remember sitting around with my bass player going, "What a bunch of sellouts. They suck." And he was like, "You don't get it. You suck. They're doing well. We're failing." And I was like, "You suck too." And we would fight about, you know, whether or not we were getting our due or not. I remember, God, one guy told Kurt, Kurt was like having to like sit down with these executives trying to get us signed. And one guy was like going, "We're going to have to lose the name Meat Puppets if we want to sign you. We'd love to work with you guys, but we won't work with a band named Meat Puppets." And some other guy was like, "You're a good looking guy who fronts a rock band. Would it kill you to pump a little iron?" And that kind of crap. And I was just like going, "I would rather fail. I would rather live in my mother's bedroom for the rest of my life than work with these fuckers." And, these people, some of them really loved us, and they all loved us. But the thing is like, and I had the same experience, and you probably have a day job too. The people are pretty nice, but the basic underlying concept that brings us together, the assumption about what we're doing, is soulless and evil. The idea that, like, well, you know, you're not supposed to talk about what you make, right? Or you're not allowed to complain about this, or if the boss asks you to do something that you're not getting paid for, or wants to not pay you overtime for work, you know, that's just because you have passion. And if you don't let them screw you, you're not a team player, and all this stuff. And the same thing, and again, in this Choke Point Capitalism book brings it home really well. Cory Doctorow is a really, really excellent writer. I love his stuff. It's just like, you know, you get like you get on the Facebook and you release a list of dates that you're doing, and nobody will like go and go, I love you guys. You guys are the best band in the world. You're better than the Rolling Stones. You're even better than the Beatles. You're even better than Frank Sinatra. What they will say is, well, why aren't you coming to my town? Or why yeah. haven't you made it easier for me to be a soulless consumer? And I'm just like, guys, start your own band. See what it's like, you know?
Right.
But it always bothered me. And it definitely bothered me in the 90s, to bring it back to your nostalgic podcast, that we were being asked to help feed our fans' desire to be soulless consumers. Mm. And I always felt that it was that there should be a certain level of friction between the artist and his or her fan base, that you take a live situation, a jazz situation from the old days, if you will. It's like the audience is there to provide basically the audience is there to remove the net from underneath you, right? So it's like mm-hmm. you can practice, you can play sloppy, whatever. You get in front of people, you actually want to like play good, and it's like the quantum concept, right? It's like something that's being viewed, the act of viewing something alters it, right? You familiar with that concept?
Mm-hmm.
It's like having people watch you do your shit changes how it is. And that's the role of the audience. The audience's role is to help us focus what we're doing into something that's real. It's like, I mean, this room here, this is where we will play. Chris and I will play here in my office. And mm-hmm. it's fun. We fart around. We enjoy it. We wonder what's the point. But when you're in front of an audience, it's really obvious what the point is. It's like, it's a beautiful thing. And that's what rock and roll is so, what makes it so wonderful and so viable. It's like when you're sitting there with the right mindset about trying to fucking open your head up, like to get your head out of the game, to put yourself in the moment and make the rock, you know, the jungle dance music that's designed to drive Elvis Presley's teenage female fans out of their heads, or to make the Beatles fans scream or whatever, that's still viable. But it doesn't happen unless the audience and the band can open their heads up, let it go, and just go for it, at which point nothing else matters. And so when I see people on Facebook going, well, you know, I saw you guys in 1982, and quite frankly, I haven't followed you guys since Meat Puppets 2 or whatever. I'm just like going, dude,
what's the point of commenting?
Go for it.
What's the point of going onto anyone's social media to say things like that, though?
Well,
that's what I don't understand about people.
It's early days. It's viable, right? I mean, it's like it's an amazing situation where we have these platforms where people could get in there and say stuff. It's cool. It's great. It doesn't mean that it's what I necessarily want to hear, or it's just discordant.
It's not productive.
No, but you know, there's more to life than productivity. It's good that it's discordant. I like discordia. I am a discordian. But that doesn't change the fact that if I hear something, you know, it's the old joke. It's like, are you coming to bed, honey? No, I can't. There's something wrong on the internet. It's like, it's just the internet. It's slowly but surely, we're starting to understand that the internet isn't real. It's not going to make or break your life. I mean, very slowly but surely. I would very much like it if people realized that the internet is a fantasy that people just hang out in. And it's like trying to make a living off. It's like, imagine if somebody wanted to try to make a living off of me taking my garbage out or something like that. It's just like, come on. Stop trying to monetize people standing around scratching their asses. It's ridiculous. I don't visit the TikTok more than maybe once or twice a decade, but I come to understand that these young people are like, they have their parents managing their like ability to do Michael Jackson dancing for money. They get free sneakers and money just for like posting dumbass videos that people look at on their phones. Really, when we're in the midst of a economic and ecological crisis, not to mention the fact that this and this thing that we're recording on right now is a cruel product of extreme exploitation bad decisions. Mm-hmm. And I see you have a keyboard back there. Do you play as well?
Not well. I'm more of a vocalist, yeah. But yeah not
I,
well.
I have this one. This little guy right here. Just a little tiny.
Wow.
And that's just enough for me to fake it if I need to flesh out. if we do a really cool jam and I just want to add like some keyboard noise to it or something like that. But aside from the downsides of social media, I got into computers, when my neighbor sold me his Mac Mac 2s or something like that for like $1,500. And I was like, oh, I love this thing. I love to make music on the computer. I love to digitize my old, it's like I can make a record at home costing nothing by just buying a card, digitizing it, giving it to the label. Nobody cares. It's all good. You're only going to sell to about, 500 people. Even if you're Elton John, you're not going to be selling as much as you did in 1975. But it's so much fun. And people are so engaged. Even if the Facebook is a little creepy, everybody's got a chip on their shoulder. Everybody's got an agenda. Even your racist right wing crazies. I've been living with those people my whole life. They don't fool me a bit by pretending to take the high road. They're the same lovable screw ups that they were back when Catherine Coleman used to send us lies in the mail when I was a teenager. So it doesn't faze me any. And what's cool about it is that even though as much as I hate Facebook, and as much as that, you probably noticed that I got tired of people saying, when are you coming to my town? So I put a automatic response in Facebook saying, yeah, we don't actually check this. And we're not going to respond because most of the crap we get is just like, hey, listen to my record. Hey, why aren't you as good as you were in 1984? Why aren't you playing in my town and other pointless stuff? But I still every once in a while get an opportunity to chat with a nice person like yourself, which is very cool.
Yeah, I mean, I can see that it would be, frustrating to a point to get a lot of the same mindless type of messages. But it is cool when you meet somebody that actually wants to know about what you're doing and share, you know?
What's frustrating is getting old, sister.
Yeah.
Well, obviously,
stop doing that. That's for sure.
Yeah, no, that's one thing you need to come to terms with. But obviously, I'm used to doing interviews and I can run off at the mouth nonstop. And I apologize for.
No, I love it.
We'll be right back.
Yeah.
Dope Nostalgia listeners, I love you and I thank you so much for being a part of this show and its success over the last 2 years. We have what's called Patreon for those who want to support the show financially. For as little as $1 a month, you can become a subscriber and get bonus content, early podcast release, all kinds of cool behind-the-scenes stuff, and more. There's different tiers of membership starting at only $1 a month. And we even have some special merch for you guys who are in it for the long run. So please join our Patreon. It's at www.patreon.com/dopenostalgia.
Ever watch a movie so bad that it made you laugh? We have, and that's what we enjoy at End of the Reel. We're just two brothers doing a podcast about bad movies. Sometimes the movie will leave you in tears from laughter, other times pain. From classics like The Room, Troll 2, and B-Movie, bad movies are here to stay. Check us out at endoftheReel.com.
Double your pleasure, double your fun.
That's the statement of the great men in Double Men Gum. Double your sentiments, your merriment. Double your moment of fun.
Double your delightment with the right mint. For refreshment, it's the only one. Double your pleasure, double your fun.
That's the statement of the great men in Double Men Gum.
Like I mentioned earlier, I'm really into comics. And there's this one comic guy who I really used to admire back when I was a teenager. And like a couple weeks ago, I was like, you know what? If he's still alive, which he was, I bet he's done a handful of interviews and podcasts by this point. It's hard to avoid it. And I found like 30 podcasts by this guy. And I'll be damned if he didn't say the same thing in every single interview. Everybody asked him the same six stupid questions, and he gave the same stupid answer every time. And none of them answered the questions that I wanted to ask him, which was like, you know, more nuts and bolts. It's like, how, you know, how does this affect this? What were the constraints you're under, whatever? And the last time I did a podcast with some fellas, not the last time, last one I did was with Lydia Lunch. She's a lifer too. And we were able to find common cause in our mutual hatred for the world, which is wonderful. It was very empowering to talk to her. I had never met her before. Not for decades and decades. But I talked to these guys, and when they got to the questions like, how would you categorize your music? And I was like, hold on, full stop. I don't answer dumb questions like that. Let me put it quite that badly. But I was just basically like, yeah, we're not really talking about categorization. Really? You don't really think I categorize myself, do you? It's ridiculous. And then it's one of those things where they do the interview, then they do the podcast. So they get to like bookend my interview with their own like after the fact stuff, which is hardly fair to the artist, I would say. It's like they get to like comment on what I said after the fact. And they're like, yeah, Bosmer's a little rough on us. And I felt bad because they were creaming all over us. They really loved it. In fact, I learned things about the band that I didn't even know. And I'm in it from listening to them talk about it because they were into guitar. And they were talking about how on the album Too High to Die, about all the interesting guitar stuff that they'd noticed that our guitarist, Kurt, does. And I don't know anything about guitar. I'm just a drummer. And I felt bad by giving them my standard, this kind of crap you're getting right now. This is like this bombardment of Bostrom's key messages. And I felt like, God, you know, I should let other people talk occasionally. Sorry.
makes my job easy. I like hearing what you have to say, you know.
Thank you.
Yeah, there are things that I definitely want to touch on as far as like the stuff for the three albums that you released as a band in the 90s. Looking back at those three albums, were there some album tracks or deep cuts that you wish you could have had blown up? You know, because obviously Backwater blew up the way it did.
Yeah.
Were there other songs that you felt that about strongly about?
Well, we actually didn't much care for Backwater much back then. We did the first album, which was Forbidden Places, with Pete Anderson, who is it was worked with Dwight Yoakam. And this was before Nirvana had blown up. So the idea of like having us kind of do country punk seemed like a good fit. The label was adamant that we use a producer, even though we'd always done our own records, more or less, along with Spot, the SST house producer. And Forbidden Places is great. We did Sam, we did a cute video of it. It was a cute little song. There wasn't much else on that record that was really that the label wanted to release as a single, although they Pete really liked Nail It Down, which is kind of a more of a kind of a blues rocker, a little bit more of a of an ass shaker, not really quite our style, but Nail It Down was pretty cool. That record didn't do anything particularly. So trying to get them to agree to do our next record was like pulling teeth. They like kept submitting demos to them, and they're like, "I don't hear a single. I don't hear a single."
The
And then
usual.
Kurt made the mistake of sending them a song that I had done that was just kind of a parody of Jane's Addiction, and they liked that. And they wanted to release that. And we were like, man, that's not a Meat Puppets song. That's not what we do. That's just one of Bostrom's goofy joke things. But they were like, yeah, but we can sell this. And like, yeah, but we're not going to do it. And it was a big fight. And eventually, all they would let us do was they're like, all right, you guys are a failure. We've obviously failed. What we're going to do is we're going to bump you down to one of our subsidiary labels. I don't even remember the name of it. And we're gonna let you guys do an EP of acoustic versions of some of your classic SST songs, like Lake of Fire, stuff like that. And then in the meantime, Paul Leary had come on board, and Paul was doing well. He had done a good record with Butthole Surfers, which had gotten a lot of success. And so he agreed to produce us. So we did that EP of stuff and a bunch of other stuff. And they were like, oh, this has sounded pretty good with Paul. We'll let you continue, provided you put Bostrom's song on there. And we were like, okay, anything to get a record made. And so we did the record, sans Bostrom's little song. And then we get down there, the big head of the label comes down. And he's like, sounded real good, but where's the goofy song that we like? And we're like, oh yeah, we got that, we're doing that, no problem. And then we submitted the record without the cute little song, and they're like, you bastards, where's our little song? So they made us go back in and spend 15 grand doing this song,
Oh.
which has never been released. It was just, and the thing is, like, my demo was pretty funny because my shit is pretty focused, but that's my shit. I'm not about to make the Meat Puppets like my little joke shit. So each version that we tried was shittier and shittier. It was just not a Meat Puppets thing. So eventually they're like, all right, never mind. In the meantime, they talked Butch Vig, who was hot at the time, into mixing Backwater, and they put their boats behind Backwater, and they called in their favors, and they got Kurt Cobain to say nice things about us. And then just by happenstance, we were touring with Nirvana right before they were going to do their Unplugged thing. And they wanted to learn some E-Puppet songs to do them. And Kurt was like coming to party. He was a basket case. And they're like, well, why don't we just come on and do the show with you? And he loved the idea of like getting some moral support like that. MTV was aghast that they brought these know-nothing hippies on stage with them. They're like, he's like, yeah, I got some special guests that I'm going to bring on. And they're like, cool, maybe it's John F. Kennedy Jr. But instead it was the Meat Puppets. And they're like, but it was good for us, you know, because being on the Unplugged thing made it possible for the label to sell Meat Puppets. And we got a gold record out of it, and Backwater did really well. But it's not like it happens on the strength of, you know, your personal love for this song, which you heard on the radio. It's because the label had no other choice. They backed themselves into a corner, backing a horse that nobody wants to do. And, you know, if you sign an artist and they fail, that means you fail. So you got to like call in your favors. And anyway, we worked our asses off in 1994, toured the whole year, you know, wound up deeply in the hole at the end, did this terrible video for a song called, well, it's not a terrible video, it's a nice video. I'm sure it was like horrifically expensive, but for some reason, the director decided to put like stereotypes in it, like sassy black mama and, Mexican gangsta or whatever. And MTV is like, this is kind of offensive. We're not gonna show this. So we didn't manage to follow up Backwater with anything. And that just record died. And then interestingly enough, they gave us enough rope to hang ourselves with the next record. At that point, they didn't give a damn what we did. They didn't fight us on anything. They just said, sure, whatever you do, whatever you want, we don't care. And then that record sank without a trace. And then all the
like, I'm speechless. Like, how did they do this to you? It's like,
now they did it to everybody.
Screwing themselves over.
Well, it's because all they wanted to do was, you know, they basically took the cream of 1980s and 90s alternative bands, signed them up, got their short-term profits out of them, and those bands that didn't manage to self-destruct, which was like a lot of them, they got rid of the rest of them, and they replace them with artists that were like, you know, in the alternative mode, they're the grungy guitars, you know, and the kind of semi rappy beats or whatever. And, you know, they were willing to play the game. They're much easier to deal with. Next thing you know, you got Woodstock 99. What can I say?
That's when the new metal and the post grunge stuff were starting to arise, right?
Yeah. Right. So, you know, it's just like, you know, our concept was to actually maybe not do something that we didn't feel comfortable with. But then there are people out there who don't even consider that. They'll just, you know, they're just looking for the brass ring. I got very sullen during those years. There was you get into town, and the local rep would show up with a stack this high of Slicks, which would basically be the copy of the cover, like 12x12. Just the poster of the cover, and a big several boxes of Sharpies, and so here, could you sign these? And then they'd be like, after the show, we're gonna bring in a bunch of fucking local luminaries to shake hands with you and party with the band. And I'd be like, gotta go. And wow. The next morning, Kurt would get up, and he'd be like, I had to stay up all night with these assholes. Boston, don't punk out on me on this. Don't make me have to do all the partying with these jerks. And like,
you're stuck doing it too.
And I'm here to do the shows. You know, I can't burn the candle at both ends. But it was just like, and you come to realize, and we would get back home, or you go into the local. It's like I mentioned earlier, like we could never find our records in the record stores. But during the major label period, we found our records in the stores all the time, in the used bin, because your local reps, we would get a box of them, right? And they would supplement their income by selling them to the secondhand record stores. It's called,
serious?
Yeah, it's just your standard kind of a thing. It's just so much waste in big business. Wow. There's just so much waste in big business. And, you know, the palms get greased by, like, you know, who you know, largesse, parties, certainly not on the strength of, you know, my naive desire for us all to get together on stage and go for it. That's the last thing anybody cared about. Anyway, I'm not real sorry that we don't do that anymore, because honestly, we didn't make any extra money. It just hurt our egos. It made it harder for us to deal with each other as a band. It ended up busting us up. And now we're like a footnote to Nirvana's career. And nobody, it's like, it's amazing. You go on social media, especially on Instagram, and there's always people. So you do a search for the Meat Puppets. Like, you do a search on Meat Puppets on Instagram. It's like half pictures of Kurt Cobain. And the other half are people doing covers of the songs that Nirvana covered on Unplugged, saying, mm-hmm. I'm doing this great Nirvana song. And other people would be like, you know, actually the Meat Puppets did that. And they're like, who?
That's so, frustrating, I'm sure.
Well,
whose decision was it to perform those songs in that show?
Oh, it was Kurt wanted to do it. We had seen an interview with him in Spin magazine in the summer of 93, talking about how he was having to do this and how he had it's like he was really into the Meat Puppets too, and Courtney didn't like it at all. He's saying in this interview, and he's like going, so I sat down and played some of these songs for her, and then she got it. And I realized, oh, I have like my own kind of take on this. So he figured, you know, it's like Courtney didn't like the Meat Puppets till he sang them to her. And then he realized I could do these songs on Unplugged. Then I don't have to do quite so much of my own crap, and I'm into them. They were really into helping other artists. They would like let one of their favorite bands open with them for them every week. Like, we got to do a week with them, and then another band would do it. And so they were doing as much as they could to promote the bands that they loved. Bands like the Vaseline's, great band from Scotland. That's just one that comes to mind that we really like here at the house. So, you know, the idea of him bringing the Meat Puppets to the masses because he felt like it spoke to him, that's great. It's the only money we ever made was from that record. And, you know, every so often they'll release the deluxe, you know, 100th anniversary of it or whatever. And, you know, a little bit will trickle down our way. So it's all good.
Yeah, it helps in some ways.
Yeah. And then, you know, eventually folks like yourself get around to interviewing us about it. And I love to talk about it. So. Mm.
And I mean, obviously that performance would have been a very memorable one for you, but that one as well. What other memorable performances stand out in your mind?
Well, I remember there was one show we did, the really big ones, like when you're going to do some sort of event and suddenly it turns into like a huge thing. Like we did some big festivals on the East Coast that were amazing, because they were like our first shows that were like, you know, tens and tens of thousands of people. The Nirvana shows we did with them were great. We played with them on New Year's on Halloween when Christ dressed up like Slash, or maybe it was Pat dressed like Slash and Kurt dressed up like Barney. And they had like a battle to the death between Slash and Barney. That was fun. And, you know, just, I mean, there's so many. I mean, honestly, the last show we did, we were going to do two shows in San Francisco. And we did the first one. And the second one, we were sick with COVID, so we had to cancel it. We were in the show an hour before going on stage. And we realized one of our guitarists was down for the count. So we had to cancel like an hour before we went on stage. But that show, the last show we did, which was just last May, was like great. And playing with a five-piece is tremendous fun. When we were a three-piece, obviously we were a lot more spontaneous and we could like crank it out. There's a show, one show comes to mind, I have a video of it, I posted on our YouTube channel, of when we had finally come to terms with the label to work with Pete Anderson. And he came out to see us do a show in, it was like January of 1990. It was during the Gulf War, the first Gulf War. Mm-hmm. And I remember I had a bunch of pamphlets I printed out, and I was like, left them at the gig and nobody cared. Most of our audience couldn't have cared less about what was going on in the Gulf. But I'm pretty sure we were dosed. And certainly the video suggests to me that we were. And it's like, you watch Kurt and he's just like, how does he ever play guitar so amazingly? He's just astounding. We're so tight with the record that we hadn't even recorded yet, the Forbidden Places, but we'd been like knocking these songs around for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And we're doing this stuff basically to show our new producer what we're about. And it was like crazy. It's like Kurt would like, he played with a quarter back then, and he would keep his quarter like kind of, you know, like tucked between his two fingers. And he would do this crazy finger picking thing. And then he would grab the quarter and do these insane power chords with his using the pedals and stuff like that. And then go back to finger picking. And then we would like turn to each other and go, all right, speed up. And we go, bur, 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 and go faster, 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 faster. And then it would go as fast as it can. And then we go, turn the whole thing into stars. And just, you know, it would build into like this like volcanic explosion of noise. And then it devolved into like 20 minutes of this insane psychedelic noise and theater. Cause we would be like, you know, telling jokes and riding around on each other's shoulders and stuff like that while still playing and making horrendous faces. And the audience is just going nuts. And afterwards, our new producer says, well, I can see why nobody wanted to sign you. And then he's like, we're going to have to get you guys in early before we do the recordings to rehearse. And he tried to crack the whip on us. And the boys pulled him aside and said, we ain't having that. That's not the way this is going to go down, motherfucker. And even still, he flew all the vocals and did all the auto tuning and all that stuff and made us use the click track and then, you know, mixed it in a kind of, I don't know, mainstream sort of way. It's still a great album. Don't get me wrong. But it always strikes me the contrast between the show that we did to show him what we were about and what he took from it was so, you know. And another time we were in New York playing at like Wetlands, I think was the name of the club, something like that. And we would like play our show. And then if we had a hair up our ass, we'd play another show of songs we didn't know. We would just like jam for like 20 minutes, for an hour, whatever, 45 minutes. Sometimes it would come out good. Sometimes it didn't. And I remember our manager, who we'd been forced to hire a manager once we'd signed up with a label. He comes back, you know this guy for like, you know, 6 months. And he says, all the label people left. You guys are going to have to stop doing those extended encores of songs you don't know. You guys need to just stick to 50 minutes of your best material. And we're like, we went on tour with Stone Temple Pilots. And it wasn't Steel Wheels, but it was still, they had a lot of employees, they had a lot of people working for them, a full office staff, and definitely a guy standing on the side of the stage with a watch going, and it's like, you are off after 40 minutes, not 40 minutes and 10 seconds, 40 minutes. So I used to bring a watch on stage and have our set timed, and about halfway through, my bass player's like going, I want to play different songs, I want to do this. I'm like, dude, this isn't our show. We have to play we need to like stick with this. It was great. Cause we had, we were doing like, it was a killer set. We had like this nice little 20 minute hunk of acoustic stuff we did. And then we did this raucous stuff and we ended with a big splash of like improvisatory noise. It was a really nice little set, but we did it every night for 6 weeks. So,
It gets boring. It gets dull for you know, your creativity.
No, that's the challenge. The challenge is to not make it boring, damn it.
Can you do that? You change it up. You change the songs up enough that it keeps it interesting for you?
No, you just make sure there's somebody there at the side of the stage right before you go on that's got a couple of lines for you. It's a long career. We started in 1980. We stopped in 96. I took a couple, the whole band took a break. Kurt and Chris got back together in like 2006. Mm-hmm. I joined about 10 years later. We got a lot of records out. People love us. People like yourself, who I've never met before. Honestly, people she and I have never met before this time.
It's true.
Know who I am, and now I know who you are, and it's fun. It's fun to do. It's weird because what we're doing here. This is not the world that most people live in. We get to have a lot of fucking fun making art and making music, and if you happen to be the kind of person who's not just in it for the money or for the lols or for whatever, you can explore art in an interesting way. You always could. When the money men come in, that usually means the party is over. Mm. But you can easily, a lot of places that have parties will have a fire extinguisher, and you can pull it out and spray it in the man's face, and he will leave you, and then you can be free again. I believe that was
your creative self.
Yeah, that's another, I believe that's another fun show that we did with the Chili Peppers, who were popular at the time, and we were doing a show with them. And at the end, it was like, everybody came on stage to jam or whatever at the end. And I believe one of my boys found the fire extinguisher out back and started spraying the fire extinguisher around on stage. Chili Peppers weren't into that so much.
Aw, I thought they'd be more fun.
Well, fun's fun. Anyway, my voice is starting to give out and I have to pee. Okay. So
I was going to wrap things up right away. I just wanted to say, I learned a lot from you today. And I mean, I'm glad that you are now in a situation where you guys can truly express your creativity without the man saying you're out of time.
Or the woman. They're not all men anymore.
True. Well, that's a good thing. But I'm glad you're in a position now to really explore what you want to do with music and be and express all that talent that you guys have the way want.
Well, the point I want to make is that we all should be doing that. You know, it's not just nice that I can do it. We should all spend a lot more time exploring the outer edges of what we think. The world is really kind of closing in on us. You know, I'm old enough to remember when we weren't all just waiting for the end of the world. I remember when Elvis's Waiting for the End of the World song came out, and I've been waiting for it as long as I've been around. But back when I was growing up, we didn't just assume that the world was going to fall apart. Mm. I consider the fact that the world is going to fall apart to be a huge opportunity for everybody to give it up. I remember once I saw Hunter Thompson somebody was like, he didn't talk. He was just field questions from the audience. And somebody was like going, what do you think are the causes that would cause our today's young people to get as passionate as they were back in the 60s? And he's like, there's never, ever been more than one or two causes ever worth being passionate about since the history of humanity. You know, just get into it. Just deal with it. And the kid was like, but what about the war? What about civil rights? He goes, what about reality? You know, I'm just going to keep on banging out there and pretend that I'm still in my 20s. And I recommend that at the end of this this interview, you turn around to that keyboard of yours, despite the fact that you aren't very good at it, and get into it, man.
That's a good reason to get back into it.
Thank you very much for having me on your show. I appreciate it.
Hey, and thank you for sharing your amazing stories with me and my listeners. I'm really happy that you had the time to do that. Now you can go to the washroom.
Thank you, ma'am. Enjoy the rest of your lovely Canadian day. I would try to move to your lovely country, but I'm a desert rat and I can't stand the cold.
All right. Well, if you guys get on the road, though,
let me know.
Make it up here. I will.
I wish. Jesus. Let me just go on record for saying I would like to visit everyone's town.
Yeah, that's true. for okay, you take care. Thank you so much, Derek.
Thanks, Naomi. Bye. Bye.
Social media, yeah, we've got it. Send us an email, dopenostalgiapodcast@gmail.com. Twitter, Nostalgia Dope. Or on Insta, dope_nostalgia.
This podcast is licensed by SoCan because we believe that artists should be paid for their work.